Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. What makes you laugh? What makes you sort of wake up and think of a joke someone told you and start laughing all by yourself? Well, my guest today, David Misch, has written Funny, the book, Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Comedy, and it's published by Applause, a form of Hal Leonard. Welcome. Welcome, David Misch.
Thank you.
And it is, what makes you, who makes you laugh?
Oh, lots of people. But I have been known to laugh in my sleep. And I also have a little pad next to my desk. So if I'm not cycling someone else's humor, if I've thought of something funny in my sleep, I write it down.
Well, you are a funny writer. I mean, because who else can tell you about Aristophanes and Aristotle, and you're laughing at how they talked about each other?
Well, I do my best. It just sort of happens. I don't really plan on it, but I think all comedians look at things a little askiff, a little off-center. So even if you're trying to write something serious, you tend to find a funny way of doing it.
Yeah, but you have done a history of comedy, and I must say I was very impressed with all the research you did.
I was surprised myself. I didn't know it would happen. But I must say I got sucked in. It's just fascinating, and the internet provides endless. I mean, I found myself quoting from a PhD thesis a woman wrote in the mid-80s in Sweden.
Yeah.
And it's like, what? How did I get into this? But I did. And it was fascinating, and I gave her credit in the book. We'll see if she finds out.
You also should give a lot of credit to Shakespeare.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I consider him a very good writer.
Yes. And, of course, no one ever had anything funnier than what he did with Falstaff and with the bit characters.
What's especially interesting about Shakespeare, I think, is that he was totally unafraid to mix comedy and drama, which is one of the theses of the book, that the two are almost indistinguishable. The only way you can tell the difference is by a person's reaction. But the way they're structured, the way they're thought of and put together and come out is almost identical. They use the same basic elements of surprise and of turning things around unexpectedly. Mm-hmm. And Shakespeare, unlike, I think, some modern people, was unafraid to mix them. I think nowadays, if you're a serious serious film director and you put something funny in, it's considered that it undermines it.
Yeah. No. And, of course, the main thesis here is the trickster.
Yes.
Who is the trickster?
Well, the trickster is actually a fake name, which was invented by anthropologists and historians in the last 50 years to describe a figure, a cultural figure that exists in civilizations going back thousands of years. And it's inevitable in every society that they invent a character who will undermine the basic rules of civilization, who will turn things upside down, switch things back and forth. Whenever a man dresses like a woman, whenever an adult acts like a kid, whenever a poor person suddenly becomes rich, those are all turning around of the normal status of things, and that's what Trickster reveled in. He also reveled in undermining any conventions and rules we have.
Well, of course, this was Shakespeare in Midsummer Night's Dream.
Puck is probably the best example. Yeah.
Yeah. And yet he used that same comedy when it was in Henry IV with the two small parts, the two guys talking to each other.
Mm-hmm. What I especially like about Falstaff, though, is he is one of the towering figures in comic literature because he is tragic. He is a comic figure who is tragic. And that combining of things is, I think, is what is at the key of art. And what I think a lot of, comedy is generally seen as a second-class citizen in the art world. Drama is king. And I don't think that should be true. I don't think one can exist without the other. And I think that the greatest artists, Shakespeare, Mozart, Picasso, were unafraid of combining them.
And, of course, now we come down to Fatty Arbuckle, Jackie Gleason. It's the overweight person who are all in the family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think the making fun of people who differentiate from the norm is a constant in comedy, and I think it's something that we do to make ourselves feel more comfortable, to give ourselves permission to let out hidden thoughts that we wouldn't otherwise express. Mm-hmm. And the comedians who take advantage of that, like Gleason and Arbuckle, and they're always fat, funny guys. You know, we got Jack Black now, we got Zach Galifianakis, and Chris Farley before that, John Belushi, the major one of the last 50 years. And when they are unafraid of expressing their own bodies, then it makes us laugh even more.
Yeah, including Pagliacci. Yeah, the crying clown.
Uh-huh.
Now, what set off this book?
I think I've just been fascinated by comedy, but you know, as quoted in the book, there's a famous saying by E.B. White that comedy can be dissected as a frog can, but the results will be of interest to none but the most scientific mind.
Yeah.
And I disagree with that. I take what E.B. White says about writing as gospel, but in terms of comedy, no. I think you can. It's easy to dissect comedy. You just have to tell the joke first.
How in 1976, a young man named David Mish was voted the funniest comedian in Boston.
Yes, it was an august honor. I was deeply humbled by it. I guess the only feature of that honor that maybe undermined my confidence a bit was that at the time I was the only comedian in Boston.
Where were you, at Steuben's?
No, I was at Passim, Club 47, you know, which had been a major folk hangout. Dylan and Baez had played there. There were almost, but even that wasn't a comedy club. There were literally no comedy clubs in Boston, or almost anywhere at that time.
But you had a song, Somerville?
I did. I wrote a comedic song, a humorous song. You can see it on the internet. There are links to it various
Could
places.
Could I also hear a little in person?
Is there someone here to sing it? Because God knows I won't. Actually, I will. There's one line that I am quite proud of. It's a song glorifying an ordinary working class community in Boston called Somerville. In terms that I thought songs like I Left My Heart in San Francisco and Chicago, that toddling town would do, which is they would take banal things like a man danced with his wife, okay, whoopee, and there are cable cars in this city. I thought those were not really strong selling points. So my song about Somerville, I said, at night the stoplights change their hue from red to green, then they change back from green to red. The trees stand up proud and tall, while far below the pavement hugs the ground. I thought that was a beautiful poetic image.
Isn't it awful? You could make fun of something that somebody else probably said, it touches my heart.
Well, the Somerville Times editorialized against me, saying that I was exploiting its city. The city, as much as Exxon exploits its customers. And I thought, you know, comparing me to Exxon, I printed 2,000 copies for $1 a piece of this song. But the good news is I was told just a few years ago that Somerville is a holiday lights tour where they have trolleys to take people to the best holiday light displays. And the song they play on an endless loop on the trolley was my song, Somerville.
Well, I hope you're getting a residual from it.
Yeah. I'm just waiting for that
no
check.
No royalty. Now, let's go to some of the other people here. The brothers, the Marx brothers, who was it? Leonard and
Adolf
and
Herbert.
All of them that came out to be Groucho, Chico, because a chick was what he was looking for.
Yeah.
And let me think, the other two names are.
Wait, you mean Harpo or you mean?
Harpo,
oh, yeah, Harpo and Zeppo, who is
right.
Not really one of them, but was.
But what was interesting, I didn't realize how few films they did make and how few years they were successful.
They were only about 10 years as stars.
And it was Irving Thalberg who said, come to MGM, we're going to make it a richer looking thing, and doors will close.